Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on Newsradio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Time now for our play-by-play call of the day. The Astros tie up the American League Championship Series in dramatic fashion.
First pitch. And Correa lines it deep to right field. Judge is going back at the wall. Looking up. See you later. See you later. See you later. See you later. Astros even the series at a game apiece on the walk-off home run by Carlos Correa in the bottom of the 11th. 3-2. Astros win it.
Do they know there's a train there? Oh, I'm sorry. Just kidding. So Correa, a fabulous talent. Homers to right. They win it 3-2 and 11. Tie the American League Championship Series a game apiece going back to the Bronx where it's going to get cold. And Wednesday it's going to be rainy. All right. The Eagles lost yesterday. Not a stunning revelation to this audience, as they were beaten by the Minnesota Vikings. With that, we bring in Matt Leon from Philadelphia. Hello, Matt.
Pretty good. How are you?
I'm doing okay. The Eagles take on Minnesota. Kirk Cousins decided to get aggressive, and it made a big difference. What did you think of the game yesterday?
I think it was disturbing to watch on many levels. Once again, the Eagles got off to a slow start. The pass defense was just horrid. I mean, the secondary play, specifically the corners, was terrible. But, you know, kind of lost in all this that people aren't talking about because there's it was so easy for the wide receivers is, you know, week after having 10 sacks against the bad Jets team, the Eagles had one sack on Kirk Cousins and barely touched him the rest of the game. And a lot of the problem with the pass defense, I think, is quarterbacks have plenty of time to make just about anything they want happen. But the main problem was, you know, Stephon Diggs is very good. And it really appeared like the Eagles defended him like they were surprised that the Vikings decided to try to utilize him. You know, when you have two, the one long touchdown Diggs had, I mean, him and Thielen were both wide open. I don't know quite how that happens. It makes you wonder who exactly they were trying to cover on that play. But, you know, it was a disturbing game. They got into a hole again. When it got to 24-20, you thought, all right, maybe they'll be all right. But then the Vikings just kind of dialed up the deep ball again, and the Eagles had no answer. So, but this, you're never as bad as you look when you lose, and despite that, still tied for first with a big game with Dallas Sunday night.
Absolutely. The Eagles are as talented as any team in the NFC. I think that's a safe statement to make. But what's missing? Sometimes a part is missing, a sliver's missing, and there's a domino effect to it. What do you think's missing?
Well, on offense, I think they really missed DeSean Jackson. I think you saw the first game against Washington, you know, now they got off to a slow start in that game, but once they got it cooking with him over the top, how it opened things up, he's been out since week two. He's basically missed every game except for the Washington game, and it's made the offense very much easier to defend because basically the Eagles keep everything in front of them. And like yesterday, they just, I don't know how many times they thought they were going to get the Vikings on that bubble screen. Like, I'm calling it from my couch. I know what's coming. So I can only imagine, you know, what the Vikings saw. I think that's the big problem on offense. I think they missed DeSean Jackson and the way he was, this offense was designed for him to open it up by taking the top off of it. Defensively, I'm kind of baffled as to why the pass rush is not more consistent. Mm-hmm. I mean, they miss Michael Bennett and Chris Long from last year, no question about it. But, you know, you still got Brandon Graham, you still got Fletcher Cox. There are still guys that, you know, you would think would be able to get to the quarterback more consistently. This was supposed to be the big year Derek Barnett breaks through. And he hasn't been terrible by any means, but, you know, he hasn't kind of taken it to that next level. You know, and I kind of... in a way, I kind of look at the Eagles' cornerbacks a lot like I look at the Phillies' starting rotation, other than Aaron Nola. Yeah. They got all these young guys that everybody loves to talk about, and you kind of figure, all right, one or two of these guys is really going to take a step and blossom. And they all seem to make the same mistakes, if not regress, from last year. Now, Jalen Mills and Ronald Darby are supposed to practice this week, and they, in theory, could come back for this Dallas game, and that would help. But to be fair, those guys had their issues. I mean, Mills has been out all this year, but Mills had his issues last year before he got hurt, and Darby had his issues before he got banged up. I don't know if that's a scheme thing. I don't know if the inventory's been overvalued. But there's just something off defensively that it doesn't make sense to me. The product on paper isn't matching what we're seeing on the field, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, that does make sense. Fletcher Cox, though, and I think I brought this up to you a couple weeks ago. I know in this league there are times you have to play hurt. He doesn't quite seem 100% to me, and I think, Fletcher Cox at 80 or 85% is a heck of a player. But sometimes they keep that last 15% keeps you from being the over-the-top player. And the Eagles seem to feed off of him.
Yeah, and to be fair, I agree with you. There are some plays. He makes a lot of plays that don't show up in the
right
in the box score. And that's kind of the nature of defensive tackle is really if you're doing your – you could have zeros across the board and have a great game because you're taking up space and you're taking up guys. You would just like to see – some more numbers, some more big-time plays, and we haven't seen that. And like I said, he's not alone. You know, I think last week, even though the Jets were terrible playing a practice squad quarterback, I think a lot of people thought that maybe the defense had kind of found its stride, kind of found its moxie because of they were coming from all angles. But then what we saw yesterday was pretty much kind of what we've seen most of the year as far as the lack of a consistent pass rush and breakdowns, you know, just egregious breakdowns in the secondary where really talented wide receivers are running free, and that just really shouldn't happen. I mean, you could have issues at corner, but you know, you still got Malcolm Jenkins and Rodney McLeod, a couple of pretty savvy veterans in the middle there, and you would hope that that would minimize the damage, but, you know, that really hasn't been the case. So I don't know. I mean, we're six games in. There's still a lot of football to be played, but I also kind of think we're maybe getting to the point where you say with the defense, hey, you know what? It is what it is. Like, you know, we can talk about guys rounding into form, returning from injury, but, you know, I wonder if there's not enough data in to say, you know what? They're going to have to score 35 a game because the defense just isn't going to be able to get it done. We'll see. Maybe Mills and Darby make a big difference if they're able to play this week and all of a sudden the secondary makes more sense with Douglas in the slot and stuff like that, and we kind of all breathe a sigh of relief. But I don't know. Because, I mean, the Vikings' offensive line is nothing special, and it's banged up, and the Eagles couldn't do much to get through it. So
Dallas is the classic case of the networks trying to will a team back to greatness. look, here they come. Are you sure? I'm not quite sure. I see what you guys are seeing over the production truck.
Okay. Yeah.
But in this division, where right now I believe even the Giants are a game back, so is this one of those, okay, you can really get some momentum coming out of a game like this, or now you can really run up a flag and say, we got a problem here?
Yeah, I think there are certain games that are kind of, for lack of a better term, like leverage games in your schedule where pressure points, shall we say, where a lot of what's going to happen the next several weeks will be determined on your performance in this game, and I think this is one of them. You know, everybody loves Dallas, and they were 3-0. Oh, here they come. Dak Prescott better than this guy, better than that guy. All of a sudden, they played some better competition, you know, and the Jets, and they've lost 3 in a row. And for a lot of the game on Sunday, they looked terrible against the Jets. But the Jets being the Jets, Dallas probably still should have won the game because of how the Jets played the last 8 minutes. But, you know, Ezekiel Elliott.
That's a team that doesn't know how to win. That's what that is.
No, I mean, you've got Le'Veon Bell, and they're throwing seam patterns up 12 with 12 minutes to go. Like, I don't get it. I don't understand. But that's a different
look who's running the show.
A different day. Well, you just want, like, what in the world did you spend all the money to get Le'Veon Bell if you're going to, you know, force the ball to
I hear
over
it.
The hill wide receivers. Like, it just in that situation, that is picture perfect why you want a Le'Veon Bell there. It just, I was bought my, not really having a dog in the fight. I'm watching that game going, what are they doing? What is the point of this play calling? It's absurd. And sure enough, Dallas gets opportunity after opportunity to come, you know, marching down the field because the Jets insisted on lengthening the game. But Amari Cooper getting hurts.
Yeah.
And he's a guy that obviously destroyed the Eagles last year. I think he had 200 and some odd, three touchdowns in one of the games. I don't, it doesn't sound like it's a serious injury, but if he can't play, that is big. But I think we've also got to look, you know, there is nothing in the recent history with this secondary that tells you that Tavon Austin won't drive them nuts. So, you know, the Cowboys have issues. The Eagles have issues. Whatever team wins this game is going to feel like they've solved a lot of their issues, and whatever team loses this game, I think especially if it's Dallas, if it's four straight losses and they lose this game on their home field and in prime time, you'll really get a lot of panic down there. But, you know, this division, I think it's a lot like the baseball National League wild card race was, where I think teams will be in it till the end,
yeah,
just because no one will be able to put the division away until week 16 or 17.
Yeah, Philadelphia, Dallas, and the Giants all started the season at 2-0 because they have the Redskins. Finally, I want to remind everybody of your fabulous podcast.
101 with Matt Leon. This week, the latest one available right now is with Cabrini men's lacrosse coach Steve Colfer. He led the Cavaliers to their first ever national championship, and we talk about that that wonderful ride and his incredible success, where he's won 80% of his games out in Radnor. And then on Wednesday, the newest one being available will be with Drexel men's basketball coach Zach Spiker. Good stuff.
Really good stuff. Hey, Matt, thanks so much. Appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Matt Leon from Philadelphia, back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Great to have you with us on the show today. Dave Cecchini, next half hour. Following the win over Colgate over the weekend, and the first win for Dave Cecchini at Bucknell. So, looking forward to talking to him about that. It'll be great to talk about a lot of the positives out of that game. And there were a lot of positives. Tonight, the Lions and the Packers. You can get us up to date here on how we stand. I guess the King had another good weekend.
He was 6-1. Rose, the boat's treading water a lot. I was 3-4. I said 2 weeks ago, I'm out of this thing already. There's just no way I'm going to catch up to the King here. So I'm like 3 above .500.
Oh.
Yeah, not good.
Yeah.
After a rough 3-4 week. Yeah, King was 6-1, you were 5-2, and me a deplorable 3-4.
Ooh.
Why I chose the Dolphins, I have no clue. I'm thinking, I thought,
well, it was a 1-point game, right?
Yeah, but the starting quarterback, it's just, you know, he's just turning into a NFL bust. Didn't work out in Arizona. Just doesn't look like a good fit in Miami.
Hmm. First 50 games of Chip Kelly's coaching career, 36-14. Last 50 games between the Eagles and UCLA, 13-37. That's not good.
Mm-mm. I tell you who else was really not all that good yesterday was just whipping around the NFL quick, NFL quarterbacks, Jameis Winston and Marcus Mariota. Mariota got yanked out of that game yesterday, and I tried to watch that game from the UK yesterday morning. And Winston was just a tough watch. I'm wondering if they're going to be on different teams next year.
Yeah, they might be.
Yeah.
We got back at 4 in the morning, So I was asleep for a while yesterday. And then I went out and did what I'm supposed to do. I cut the lawn yesterday afternoon. The last night, so I watched no NFL yesterday. Then I went and watched my grandson play his flag football game. Then I went to practice. And then I put the Steelers on, but it was mostly background for me while I was working on Penn State and Michigan. So I didn't really see a lot of NFL yesterday. Oh, well. Now, I know Temple won because my brother sent me a text before the Iowa kickoff.
Hashtag Temple Tough.
Yeah.
Yeah, he chose Temple on Saturday. Yeah, upper management was at the game on Saturday.
I know.
Yeah.
I know they were, yes.
It was either a family weekend or homecoming for Temple this past weekend.
Well, you know what? And Temple's got SMU this week, I believe.
That should be a really good game, too.
Actually, should be. SMU 6-0. But Temple, see, I watched the Maryland Temple tape, and the first thing I called up Jack, and I said, I'll say this. I said, heck with Maryland. I said, Temple bullied them. I mean, Temple's a tough, hard-nosed physical football team. I like the quarterback, too. So I had a chance to at least see them on tape. So I watched because I watched the Maryland game. And they imposed their will in that game. So. Well, that was a great win for them beating Memphis. Great win. Georgia lost. You know, South Carolina was using their third string quarterback. Still won the game. And
I'm glad Michigan beat Illinois, but I kept checking score updates on that Saturday. I was like, "Whoa, boy, they have a chance to lose this thing."
I can't quite get a hand. I was watching the tape this morning. I can't quite get a handle on how good Michigan is. I mean, there's certain players I can look at. Certain players and go, "Boy, he can play. Hutchinson can really play. He's good. Quiddy Pay's really good." Uche's really good. Metellus is really good. Hill's really good. You know, and I'm looking at a couple of the wideouts, the running backs, whatever. I'm thinking, oh, boy, man, I can see a lot of talent there. I just can't quite get a handle on how good they are. Just can't. I mean, obviously, we're going to find out firsthand on Saturday night. I mean, we'll find that out firsthand, how good they are. The atmosphere is going to be electric. It's going to be wild. It's going to be fun. And we will set the scene for you there. The Niners are still undefeated. How many of you had that in your pool? Nobody. I don't even think the Niners management thought that was possible.
That defense is legit out there, and the Rams are in trouble.
Yeah.
Rams are in trouble.
Los Angeles is a market's in trouble. That is a market that desperately needs a winner. Let me say this about the Steelers for a moment. Devlin Hodges did a terrific job last night. This is an interesting time to be a Steelers fan. Every time the Steelers have done something over the last decade and a half, it's been with expectations. Expectations bring with it offseason excitement. It also brings with it tension. Nobody has any expectations for the Steeler team. And at least for the moment, for a Steeler fan, isn't that fun?
These
don't have expectations?
Well, the ironic part of all this, what are the two facets of the team that you're not throwing up red flags about this season so far? The secondary and the kicking game. What did we talk about last year quite a bit? That was suspect to criticism. The secondary and the kicking game. But getting out of the Chargers game, just concern for Stephon Tuitt, for Tuitt, peck injury. Usually peck injuries don't turn out all that good, so you just hope it's not a terrible sign he's going to be out for a huge amount of time.
Did the Steelers have a bye week coming up?
They do. Couldn't have asked for a better time for that.
Wow.
So they'll give Mason Rudolph a little more time to get out of concussion protocol and think he would be good to go and back up to the starting role. 2 weeks from tonight, they play the Dolphins, Monday Night Football. It'll be the first of three in a row at Heinz Field.
Oh, so they got back-to-back bye weeks.
That's true. Then the Colts and then the Rams.
Well, they got a lot of bye weeks coming up.
Can only hope. Highly competitive Dave, AFC North.
Dave Cecchini, next half hour, who for the first time in his career did a winning postgame show with Kevin Herr and has lived to talk about it. Did the suit know that they won in the postgame?
For nearly 100 years, Purdy Insurance has been your locally owned, family-operated source for insurance products. With a staff of over 20 and partnerships with some of the industry's most trusted companies, Purdy has the experience and resources to get the job done. Whether you need personal, home, and auto, or complex business insurance solutions, Purdy will help you navigate through the process. Call today at 570-286-5855, or better yet, stop in their Sunbury office to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
What the heck was that dude talking about? Hey, really? Sean, don't you like it that when people agree with you?
We just finished the impeachment talks until the next show.
Well, I wasn't talking about that. I was talking about people agreeing with you.
Yeah, but sometimes it's makes it kind of boring. Some days you want to stir it up a little bit.
Oh, that's where you're wrong. I just like when everybody agrees with they were good.
Yeah. And things are more tranquil and everything's cool and right with the world. So
Yeah.
Perspective.
Okay. Well, that was a lot of fun of intellectual mumbo jumbo there. Congratulations on accomplishing it. All right. Intellectual mumbo jumbo. I can just talk circles around nothing. All right. So, okay. The show is brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And with that, we bring in Dave Cecchini, the head football coach at Bucknell. Dave, first of all, welcome and congratulations on your first Bucknell win.
Thank you very much. It was a great day, a great win, and a great environment to get the first W.
What did it mean for the kids? I mean, we can talk about what it means for you, but you're going to direct it toward the kids anyway. So what did it mean to your young men, especially confidence-wise? And did you see this building?
I did see it building. You know, we took some big steps forward the last couple weeks leading into this. Started up 14-0 against Holy Cross, played a great first half, and then let the game get away from us in the second half. And when those similar situations happened in this contest, I mean, it unfolded in almost an identical way. We went up 14-0, and then we faced a little bit of adversity, turned the ball over on punt, gave them a short field, they scored, and it was almost like, okay, are our guys going to be able to weather this storm, or are we going to fold like we did last week? And to a man, our players rose to the occasion. They said, we weren't going to let it happen to us this time around, and we got after it. And in the end, they played incredible football, offense, defense, special teams. We dominated the football game the rest of the way.
Well, this is where Alex Peachin comes in, because in the Big Ten, Blake Gilligan was the Big Ten Special Teams Player of the Week. I mean, I stood there, sat there and watched him take five punts and dump them inside the 10, and then the other three were fair caught. You've got a real weapon in Alex Peachin. What did he mean in the outcome of the game for you?
Well, he was incredible. About 3 days prior to the game, we found out that our kicker was out, wasn't going to be able to play in the game, and Peachin had to go from, he's our starting holder. He had to go to be the holder to being the kicker, kicking off, hitting the field goals, extra points, in addition to his punting duties. And he did a phenomenal job, 2 for 2 on field goals, did a great job on kickoffs, put two down inside the 10-yard line, I believe, of his five punts. And then probably the most important play of the game on our first drive, second half, we were facing a fourth down and three from midfield, and we went right out there and called a fake punt. He took it 11 yards for the first down, and that was a real emotional uplifter to keep us going, and we went on to score at the end of that drive as well. So he was phenomenal. He was just named the Patriot League Special Teams Player of the Week, and he deserves it.
And then the other part of it is the Defensive Player of the Week, Simeon Page. What did it mean to see the performance from him?
Yeah, I tell you what, he is another guy who's just gotten better and better. I mean, he's a player who's the best when we just cut him loose and just say go. And we blitzed him a lot on Saturday. He had 3.5 tackles for a loss. Three of those were sacks. He had a crucial pass breakup towards the end of the game, kind of a last gasp attempt on fourth down by Colgate to get back to make it a one-score game, and he batted a ball down. And then, of course, at the very end, got a chance to scoop up a fumble and return it for a touchdown. So, I mean, he had a dominant performance, for 60 minutes, but, he wasn't alone. It was without question the best 60 minutes of football that our defense has played all season.
Which fun was it to really close out a game on your terms?
It was great. I tell you, we laughed a little bit as coaches, but it's like we got into a 4-minute offense for the first time, and it's like it's just new territory for your players. Letting the clock tick down, and we're used to it being the opposite. Hey, get up and let's snap the football as quickly as we can. So. It was a lot of fun to finish the game that way, and of course to do that successfully. I mean, when we were trying to run clock at the end of the game, we held the ball for 5 minutes and got a couple of crucial first downs, and really just kept every time that we just needed to hold them, keep them from getting back into the game, our guys just rose to the occasion. It was awesome.
Do you like the way your passing game is getting into a rhythm, Dave?
I do. I think that Logan Bitticoffer, our quarterback, just seems to get more and more comfortable with each passing game. Of course, a lot of that goes, the credit goes to the offensive line. We did a great job of protecting him. He got sacked 3 times. 2 of those times were against the best defensive end in the Patriot League, Nick Wheeler, who got the, and he's the all-time sack leader for Colgate, which is saying something. That had a lot of great defensive players over the years, but most of the game Logan had plenty of time, was able to scramble for some big plays if nobody was open, but he was fairly accurate. The thing I was happiest about his performance on Saturday was he didn't throw an interception and didn't come close to throwing an interception, and just his judgment keeps getting better and better, and anytime you can win that turnover battle, it's huge.
Yeah, no question about it. 4 for 4 in the red zone, the ability to finish drives. What does that mean to what you're doing?
Yeah, I think it's something that we did very poorly at the start of the season. We really did struggle in terms of from our opening game against Temple, where we got it down there twice and had to set, I'm sorry, 3 times, and had to settle for 2 field goals and a missed fourth down opportunity. So really from where we started the season to where we are now, we're in a much better place. And, it's critical when you get down there, you'd like not to rely on the field goal attempt. And we were able to do a great job of getting in there 3 times for scores and only relying once on Peachin kicking the field goal. Of course, he did a great job, but it's nice to walk away with 7 points as opposed to 3.
Dave, you've won a lot in your career along the way. What is it like for you to teach from a position of victory as opposed to teaching from a position of coming off a loss?
Well, the message really I sent to the team was understand what got you this victory. I mean, it was a great week of practice. It was a great week of
you know, guys on the scout team giving a great look to our starting units, a great week of film study, preparation in the weight room. It just didn't happen magically. You know, again, we played an opponent that's a pretty good team, certainly no better, no worse than Holy Cross was the week prior. We were able to have a much better outcome in this one. But, you know, the message was just understand what got you this victory. And you've been rewarded for all that hard work, and you earned this victory. Now we got to go and do it all over again. If you're going to expect to win a football game this Saturday against a really talented Towson,
yeah,
you're going to have to do everything you did last week and then a little bit more.
I'll get to Towson in a moment, but you are now 1-1 in the Patriot. Is that more of a message than, hey, instead of being what the record is now, you're 1-1 in the Patriot? What does that mean?
Well, I think with the parity that you see in the league, I mean, we're still early on in the season. Since you only play six league contests, it's really, you know, some teams have yet to even play two league games, let alone one. So it's really close. Every game has been decided by a touchdown or less, with the exception of our game against Colgate on Saturday. So I really think it's anybody's race, and I think it's very, very feasible that it's going to be a one-loss team that winds up winning this league or shares it with another team or possibly even in a three-way tie. So we really feel like Holy Cross is 2-0. I'm sorry, they're 1-0 in the league right now. And, you know, they're in the driver's seat since they beat us, but there's a lot of parity, and I'm sure that there's going to be a team that's going to step up, possibly even Colgate later on, and get after them, and who knows? I really feel like it's going to be a team with one loss that wins the conference this year, and so the way I look at it is we've got as good a chance as anybody at winning this thing.
Down to Johnny United Stadium to take on Towson coming up. They've lost three in a row. One of them, though, was a trip to the Swamp where they were beaten by Florida down in Gainesville 38-0. What makes them one of the top 20 teams in FCS, in your opinion?
Well, they've got a great quarterback with a familiar last name, Flacco.
Yeah.
So he's been playing football for a long time at the collegiate level. I don't know how he's done it. He started off at Western Michigan, then transferred to Rutgers. Now he's transferred. He's a graduate student for Towson. He is very, very talented, like his older brother. And he really makes them go on offense. They've been a little bit Jekyll and Hyde-ish this year. I mean, they're a good football team. They lost in overtime to an extremely talented Villanova team that, of course, we faced earlier in the year. Then, of course, they lost to Florida, which is understandable. And then they really got beat, embarrassed a little bit by Albany this past weekend. Gave up a lot of big plays and third down situations. The ball bounced the wrong way, and they really struggled on offense. So a little bit hard to get a handle on them. They're very, very talented. They were ranked ninth in the country prior to getting upset. I'm sure they're still going to be in the top 20. But they're going to be fighting for their playoff lives here. You know, being at 3-3, I think another loss, against us would pretty much doom their playoff chances, and they're 0-2 in their conference right now. So I'm sorry, 1-2 in their conference. So their backs are against the wall. So they're definitely not going to overlook us. And like I said, they're very talented. When they're good, they're very, very good. So we got to be at our best and hope that we get a few bounces that go our way as well.
And that game will be 4:30 on Saturday down at Johnny United Stadium down in Towson. Dave, congratulations on the win, the first of many. And to your kids, congratulations to them. Best of luck on Saturday.
Thanks, Steve. I appreciate it. You take care.
Dave Cecchini, head football coach at Bucknell, after their win over Colgate on Saturday. We'll come back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Are you terrified by your old ride? don't fear.
If you want to have a fun day, you have to buy a Hyundai at Sunbury Motors Hyundai. Treat yourself to a nicer, newer ride from SFC. Choose from 12 2019 Hyundai Tucson's with $4,000 off,
starting at $22,369.
There's 17 Hyundai Konas in stock, starting at only $20,352. Sunbury Motors Hyundai has brand new Sonatas starting under 19 grand. Plus, hurry in. There's four Hyundai Palisades in stock. And every new Hyundai comes with America's best warranty.
10-year, 100,000-mile powertrain limited warranty.
And Hyundai Assurance. Don't be terrified by your old ride. If you want to have a fun day, you have to buy a Hyundai from Sunbury Motors Hyundai in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury.
Driving you.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, he is back. Doug in Wellsboro.
Steve,
hello, Doug. How have you been, Doug?
I've been great. I listen every day. I heard you mention me a week ago.
Okay, there you go.
What is with this John O'Neill guy?
Look, I don't know. I'm not going to get judgmental on guys because, you know.
I will.
As a fan, you can. I really can't, Doug. Yeah, I think you know that. There's certain things that for example, the Freiermuth play. I don't care. They can tell me till they're blue in the face what they say. They flat out got it wrong. Now, the other ones I can't comment on only because I'm watching the ball. So I'm not looking away from the ball. And when it comes to the replays, the doggone television set was over my head and I couldn't really look up to see it. So you had a better view than I did, believe it or not.
That pass interference call was totally bogus. That kid from Iowa spun around on his own, and that there was no pass interference on that.
Yeah, I didn't think there was pass interference on that. In fact, there was one I think they missed. I thought it was offensive pass interference when John Reed got hit. That was earlier in the game.
Is John O'Neill the same guy that made that call against Lehman out in Nebraska?
I believe so, yes.
He's had Are they evaluated at all by the Big Ten?
Yeah, that I can explain, to be honest with you, Doug. I can explain that in detail for you because we've had Bill Carollo on the show, and Bill is the head of officiating in the Big Ten. Every single play is gone over, like all of them. And Bill is evaluating while the game is going on, believe it or not. And then the officials are given after the game. After the game, it is sent to their tablets. Hey, you need to take a closer look at this play, this play, this play, and this play. I know people think, and I understand the perception, and I do understand it, so please, I'm not putting down anybody's perception at all. The perception is, oh, they just let him go and nothing's done. Bill will be the first to tell you, and he's told me this. He says, Steve, he says, believe me, I'm really hard and tough on these guys. And I do always come back to this. Let's put yourself in John O'Neill's shoes for a moment. I mean, I don't know John at all. I mean, basketball referees I know because we're courtside and we can talk to them. Football referees we never get a chance to know because there's always that distance. Do you want to be in John O'Neill's shoes today? And people are saying, you're awful, you're terrible. I mean, nobody wants that feeling. Well, maybe the suit does. He seems to thrive on it.
Yeah, but he makes the same mistakes over and over. This is going on for a while now.
And that is, to me, that's the concerning part. The concerning part to me is if you are making the same mistakes over and over, that is a problem. And that then becomes an issue with all this if you're making the same mistakes over and over. But Bill Carollo and Rick Boyajis in basketball's told me this too. When the game's over, boom, they are sending this play, this play, this play, this play, this play. Take a long look at this. We're going to talk about it on Sunday. So they do get that kind of evaluation.
I thought James handled it perfectly. That's all. I mean, I know what position he's in. He can only say so much, but I thought he handled it perfectly in his press conference afterwards.
Well, I essentially said the same thing I said on the broadcast. I said on the broadcast, I said Penn State's a team's only averages four penalties a game. That's you know, they're one of the least penalized teams in the country, and I said it. I think I said it in the middle of the third quarter. It was during the sequence where they scored the three touchdowns.
Was the plane ride back fun? I thought James had a wig on.
He did, because I was walking on the plane, and he was on the intercom, and so I walked past him, and he had the dreadlocks on, and then I just got up to Jonathan Sutherland on the plane. And I was just walking past him going back to my seat, and James came up to him, and James was right behind me, literally. And he says, "Hey, let's do a selfie." So I glanced back and thought, this is precious. Sutherland's such a good kid, Doug. You'd really like him. So,
hey, one last thing. Tell Matt McGloin he's doing an excellent job.
He sure is.
The insights he gives and the reports and stuff from the sideline and the pregame stuff, I mean, we listen to all of it, and you know, all you guys the whole time, and he's doing an excellent job. I really like listening to him.
We think he's done a tremendous job. Jack and I have tremendous respect for him, and he brings an insight that's really valuable to the broadcast. I mean, Penn State fans are really lucky. I mean, you got Jack Ham and you got Matt McGloin, who both have the ability to take you inside and tell you why and what's happening and how it happened. And Penn State fans are really lucky to have those two guys.
Well, K's got Kevin Herr, so there you go.
Well, you know, not everybody can have the ultimate home run hitter, the Babe Ruth of broadcasting, but WKOK does with Kevin Herr.
Okay, thanks for your time, Steve. Thanks a lot. Thanks, Sean.
Doug, thank you. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Doug.
Yes, we've often referred to Kevin as the Bambino.
Wow, so he's upgraded. You compared him to Clayton Kershaw last week, and now you got him upgraded to comparing him to the Babe. Wow.
Absolutely.
It's quite the upgrade within the last 4 days.
No, I was just mostly thinking about off-season shape. We're big fans of Mr. 298. I'm glad that Doug brought that up about evaluation, because I have talked to Bill Corollo about that, and he explained the process. I mean, it is sent to their phones or to their tablets. I mean, sometimes they're literally sitting in the locker room after the game, and they're looking at their tablets because those are the plays that have been sent. They don't leave the locker room till they're done. So it's a little more extensive than people realize.
You're listening to News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury. You can hear us anywhere in the world with the Sunbury Broadcasting Corporation app.